So, what I want to say is, for those of you who have been in our Discord and chatting with us in Discord, if you ever wondered, like, does it really matter if I go to Discord and talk to the devs? Do they really? Yes, we totally listen. We're totally involved with people who want to come and talk to us about our game and have ideas for our game in Discord. If you have anything you want to tell us about making strategy games and how we can make our strategy games better, please come to Discord and do that. And here's one example. We actually had a very different looking Olivia. Olivia here is our lead character in the game. And we had some people who didn't like the old Olivia. They didn't like the way she looked. They didn't like a lot of the things about her. And so I said, all right, let's re-look at her. And so we're actually having a new look at Olivia. This is not final. This is one stage of the progress of the new Olivia, but we made her look a little bit more swashbucklery, a little more piratey. The backstory of Olivia is, in fact, that she has turned into a sort of privateer, piratey kind of character. There's a lot more coming as we get into the story, but the short version of Olivia is that she actually belonged to a military force, and she's military trained, and for reasons that I'm not going to tell you, because there's a bunch of spoilers involved, she was kicked out of the military, and she moved out to an island between the continent of Kothia and the old world of Cortella, where she's from. And here in the Ruman Islands, which is sort of our version of Tortuga, she hung out and developed a badass crew and sort of began her life as a privateer and a pirate. So that's who she is. So she's supposed to have a sort of piratey feel. We've done some other stuff. We've started working with a menu so that now as we switch from mode to mode, you can see up here in the upper right hand corner that your options change. Later, this piece of art that underlies this will change. So each one of these different settings will have its own individual piece of art here. So as you go from menu to menu, that'll change. So that's something that we're building. We're working on the editor, making the editor a little bit more up to date and that sort of thing. Right now, the editor is still very much a developer tool. It's not very user-friendly right now, but I reiterate, we will be shipping with an editor. You will be able to build your own maps. It's just a whole hunk of code and stuff that we haven't gotten to yet. The editor works, and I mean, you could learn how to use the editor right now, but it's not right now designed to have menus and be pretty and be something that we could ship with a game that's coming along down the road. But we're not going to do all that until we're pretty sure how we want everything in the editor to work, and we're still playing around with game stuff that we need to fix before we start solidifying all that. So there's all that. You will notice, by the way, that we have good-looking emblems. And this is a whole, if you remember from Legends of Callasia, the make your own shield system, I loved that. I thought it was fun. People really enjoyed it. We got great notes about that. People liked that. And so what we wanted to do in Last Regiment is allow you to build your own regiment. So if you go back out here, you'll see I've actually got two regiments saved right now. I've got Tristan and Friends, which is my regiment that's got Tristan and two other heroes. I got Girls Gone Wild. Trust me, that's not. I named it that as a joke because it's actually two of our female heroes, and they're gonna go wild all over Ben. That's the plan, right? And so you can actually save out, and later on we'll have the ability to save out quite a few more regiments. So you actually be able to kind of build a bunch of alternate decks. And the reason for this is the maps are different, and a lot of the units have different skills and abilities, which are going to be different on different maps. So for instance, a map that has a lot of water on it, it's probably one you want to bring some ships. A map that's got a lot of deserts on it, I'm going to have some units later that do better in deserts. A map that's got a lot of jungle, maybe you want to bring the Ivoria units that have those monkeys that do so well in the jungle. So in all of these, we have the idea is you're going to actually theme your deck to what you're going to play. But the problem is in multiplayer, I don't know what map I'm going to play until somebody starts up a game and chooses a map. So what we wanted you to do is have the ability to kind of have a bunch of these regiments stored. And then when you see what game you're going to play, you're like, oh, okay, I'll bring this regiment that I built that's a perfect regiment for map that's got a lot of jungle in it. Bam, I'm ready to go, right? And so you've got all those stored, and I thought one thing that might be fun is, what if we could actually store a emblem with each one of those regiments? So you can see right here, and this, by the way, is a placeholder menu. Later, there'll be a bigger menu with a lot more regiments. But you can see I've actually built a little emblem, and I could also name my regiment. So Tristan and friends here, when I go in, well, there's Tristan and whatever. I can name it whatever I want. And importantly, I can go in and I can build my own emblem. For those of you who played Legends of Callasia and remember the emblem building system, I took a bunch of notes from what people liked and what people didn't like from that system, and we've updated it some. So the big update is, as you can see, I've got all of these sort of different themes that I can go for, and this is separated out into tabs, so we can have all these different themes. You can have up to 4 different colors on your background. So for instance, if I wanted this background, I could, I could make, and then I can change each one of these different colors. So if I don't like that purple and I want to make that, red, and let's say I want that other red bit here to be blue. Look, that's the wrong one. That one looks to be red. And then let's see, I want this red bit to be blue. So look, it looks almost like a British flag. And this is important. One thing we are not doing is putting all the national flags in. In Callasia, we actually had all the national flags. And it was kind of fun for a little bit, but what it actually did is it made a lot of the emblems look really ugly because the national flags weren't really designed to have something put on top of them. But the other thing it did is it kind of pulled you out of the game a little bit. And it felt a little bit like... It felt a little bit like, why are you putting this reality onto my fantasy? And so what I've done instead is I've kind of given you a bunch of different emblem shapes that you could kind of use to develop your own flag if you wanted, but it actually fits within the emblem. So for instance, let's say you were Filipino, right? And you said, all right, well, there's not a Filipino flag, but what I could do, let's see if I can remember what the Filipino flag looks like. What I could do is I could make something that looks kind of Filipino-ish, right? I mean, that's not a Filipino flag, but it looks a little like a Filipino flag. I think that's how the Filipino flag looks. It's blue and red and white, something like that. So as for the emblems themselves, I'm actually in a fight with Ben about this. My argument was, hey, we had all these great emblems for Callasia, just jam them in. And he was like, no, people will be pissed off. They want new emblems. So he's made a bunch of new emblems. I actually like the ones from Callasia. These are fun too. But I'm still fighting with Ben to just shove all the ones from Callasia in. Because I thought the Callasia ones were cool. All right, there we go. That looks better. That looks way more Filipino. All right, so while I can't actually build a full Filipino flag, it's kind of close. And that's the idea, is you can do things that are kind of thematically similar, but not exactly like your national flag. So there's that. One thing we've added that's nice, you can see the edges are a lot wider than they used to be. And the reason for that was in earlier versions of this game, you would actually have your UI get in the way of the game, and it was kind of annoying. So let's say I clicked on Tristan here. It used to be the case that, like, when I scrolled out, Tristan would still be on top of my map, and that kind of sucked. I was looking at the way that we were showing information to the player, and it was a little bit confusing. And I actually went back to Callasia, and I looked at the cards from Callasia. And I thought, you know, actually the way that you looked at the information on the cards was really nice. You just clicked on the card and it popped up and you could see what it was. And then when you let go of the mouse button, it went away. And what we had before in Last Regiment was much more sort of I click on this and then over here on this side of the screen, it showed the information and maybe it was good, maybe it was bad, but I didn't like it. And so what we've done is we've now basically replicated the card functionality from Callasia. So if I'm in the middle of the game and I'm like, oh, what does this horse guy do? Bam, I can click on that, very quickly see, oh, okay, this is what the horse guy does. He does that stuff. And then when I let go, he's gone. Now, if I want to actually summon horse guy, hang on a minute, I gotta get Tristan off of my spot here real quick. So now that I've got that, I can actually grab and pull just like that. So if I want to see what's going on with him, I just click and hold, and then if I want that, if I like that, then I just drag it somewhere. Boom, done. We did the same thing over on the left-hand side with the various powers as well. So I can actually just click one of the powers and bam, there's my information. Ooh, Ben put a little effect on the edge of it that looks pretty sexy too. I didn't even notice that. So here you go. Here's all the various little powers that he's got. You can click that, hold it, and as you're clicking and holding it, it gives you that information. And then for the powers, and you'll notice some of these are circles and some of these are squares. The reason some are circles and some are squares is because I wanted to make it very, very clear. This is just some information like Farsight. I can't play Farsight. That's just something that exists on my player. That's a thing that he has. His ability to be a builder, that's not something I can do. That's just some information about him. But this cure ability that he's got, this is something I can actually play. And so if I click it, you can see, oh, he's actually going to do something there. If I go click build, that doesn't do anything. And so you'll notice that the circles mean that's something you can actually do. And the squares mean that's just some information about the player. So later on, let's say he gets a spell cast on him that gives him a negative modifier or a positive modifier or something like that. That'll be added right here as a square. The other thing that we've done a little bit differently, let me run him into this city so that you can see. All right, so there he is. He's in the city. And you'll notice now there's a top line and a bottom line, right? The top line is him. And these are the things that he can do. And the bottom line is things that this village is allowing him to do. So let's go to a place that's a little bit bigger and a little bit more, got a little bit more to do in it so I can show you more clearly. All right, so you can see he's here. Let's say he takes over this Temple of Death. Boom, you've taken over the Temple of Death. And now here's all the things that the Temple of Death can do. So it's very clear to the player, I get this ability because it's part of the Temple of Death. Some other things that we have added, you'll notice the Fog of War no longer has the big ugly crosshatch lines in it. We got rid of that, so that's looking a little better. I think we're going to do a little bit of work later to make this edge of the Fog of War look a little more organic. You can see it kind of does it here, but we're getting there. There's some more technical work to be done. But you can't see it in this map. Let me go out. There's another thing I want to show you that we've done that's I think is actually pretty cool. We've been playing around with the water. And you will notice that we now have deep and shallow water. And you also notice our oceans look a lot better. So we've been spending some time. We did this week. We spent some time on making the coastlines look a little clearer, more interesting. We've got some kind of pretty coastline going on here. And most importantly, there's now a clear differentiation between deep water and shallow water. And we're thinking right now what, you know, we did it mostly, to be honest, for aesthetic reasons, to make our oceans look a little less bland and a little more interesting. And I think our oceans do look a lot more, I don't know, Calasia-esque now. I always liked the way the oceans looked in Calasia. I think they look a little better now. So I'm liking the look of this better. But once we kind of made the decision to do a dark ocean and a light ocean, the question was brought up in the studio, maybe we should have that have a game effect. Maybe there should be units that are stronger on the deep ocean, or they can't go into the deep ocean. We're still kind of playing around with what we're going to do with that, but we certainly have that available to us now, so that's a bonus. Another thing to look at, this is a slight modification, but I think it's an important one, is you can see Ben changed our arrows. The arrows look, again, a little more Calasia-esque. I liked those better. I think this looks a little cleaner and better than the ones that we had before. And most importantly, the arrows don't sit on top of the meeple anymore. So as you move your thing around. And this is the other thing, another you might notice as I drag this around. It used to be when I started dragging, all of these hexes, all those orange hexes that you see would have like a big, ugly placeholder programmer number in the center. And that number is telling you how many movement points are you burning by going into this place. Well, we've actually now given you that information right here in a much clearer and easier to read format. So as you move, you can actually see how much each one of these movements is burning from your movement. So I know that this guy has a movement of 3, says right there in the center of his meeple. And so I can start going, okay, that's 0.5, that's another 0.5, that's another 0.5. All right, I can get to there, and that's going to be the end of my movement. So what else have we added? We added 8-player maps, and we've been playing a couple 8-player games. The game plays a lot of fun in 8 players. It's a little bit slower in 8 players because the resolution Takes a little bit longer, but it's still pretty snappy. Plays pretty good at 8 players, so that's fun. There's another feature that we can show you. Somewhere. Here we go. The game logs. So I can actually... Let's see, I had to do something worth logging. Alright, you. Build me a thing. Let's build a watchtower. So theoretically, after I build my watchtower, it will show up on the log and tell me, look, a watchtower was built, right? And you'll notice it actually shows up on the bottom of the screen too. We're playing around with this. Obviously, I've got this log here that I can open, and I can look at the whole history of the game and look at all the different things that went on. So if I'm confused about what happened, I can go look at what happened. But what I was very strongly opinionated about, something I thought we needed to do, was to make sure that while it was happening during resolution, even if I didn't have the log turned on, it would actually show down here. We're going to get rid of this sort of bizarre pumping device and maybe make this text a little bit bigger, but I want to keep that text scrolling up. Right now it's only one thing. As you play a game where we actually have more stuff happening here, let me summon some stuff and make some more. Not you, let's get you out here. Let's get a couple more things happening so you can see this in action a little bit more. All right. So now I've got a couple things that could possibly happen. Let's have you go over there. Let's have you attack Olivia. And let's see down at the bottom if we get some things there. There we go. Captain Olivia is a captain, has attacked Captain Tristan. So we get that information. I think, by the way, we need to leave that on screen a little bit longer. But there's a bunch of stuff we need to play with there, but it's getting there. That's most of the stuff we've added. I've been told that we added cone effect damage as well. I'm not sure what unit does cone effect damage right now, so I don't think it actually, I can't display it, but one of the things that we are adding is the ability for you to actually target something that's not round, but it's actually fans out as a cone, which will give us a lot more interesting options with our spells and things, so that we can have, you know, a cone of fire or a blast of fire or things like that. That's going to be in. Apparently it's in right now, but we haven't actually built anything with it. So probably in the next live stream, you'll be able to see us throwing cones of fire and things at each other. So anyway, that's what we've been up to. Lots of changes, lots of stuff. Thanks for coming by the live stream. Thanks for all the good fun. We will be back, not next week, but the week after. Next week, obviously, we'll be at ESGS. You can see us there. So there's that.